models but not the Python models have color boxes. Another, and they sit, if you look closely, so here is the TSS in the middle of the box, they sit, as is well known for color boxes, about 30 base pair upstream of the TSS. While group 1 and 2 promoters contain initiator motifs at the TSS directly to similar amounts. But when we now look at these completely differently behaving promoters of type 3 and 4, they contain, for example, this polar 1 or 6 motifs or other types of motifs, but not these types of motifs here on the left. And I think this mutual presence or absence is much more easily seen if we display that in terms of enrichment across the entire enhancement group. We now see, again in red, that the color box is most strongly enriched in cluster 1, and in fact actually being depleted in clusters 3 to 5, while the initiator is enriched similarly to cluster 1 and 2 promoters. And again, our cluster 3 promoters are enriched in this OLA 1, 6, DRE and OLA 7 motifs. And the strongest enrichment that we see for cluster 4 is actually the TCT motif, which is a motif identified by Chimpanaga that occurs specifically at the ribosomal protein 2 promoters. And you might remember that we had a ribosomal protein 2 promoter of the ribosomal protein gene 19S that actually does fall into cluster 4 and is specifically, as you remember, activated by Chimpanaga. So we have now a really cool model where the presence of these motifs dictate the binding of general transcription factors and other factors. And we could actually test this by published CHIP-seq and CHIP-nexus data from the Vienna Cycling Lab, where again, TDP is most strongly bound in cluster 1, which fits exactly to the enrichment of the color box in cluster 1. And you see this also quantified here, with the color box being most strongly bound by cluster 1. While, for example, TRF2 paralog is most strongly bound by clusters 3 to 5 promoters. And again, in agreement with the prediction by the motif enrichment, the TAF1, which binds to the initial motif, is bound to groups 1 and 2 predominantly, as you can see here quantified. While the motif 1 binding protein binds predominantly to cluster 3, again as indicated by the strong enrichment of the only one motif, that is the binding motif in promoters of cluster 3, and TREF in clusters 3, but also somewhat in clusters 4, for example. Again, coinciding with the enrichment of the DRE motif in clusters 3 and 4. So, in sum, we have looked at how cellular proteins that communicate between the enhancers and the promoters and have the ability to activate transcription show distinct compatibilities, highlighting that distinct promoters exist and that it is the sequences again of these promoters with the presence of short motifs that dictate both general transcription factor binding and then also the responsiveness to the different cofactors. And one other more unexpected observation that we made was that some of the promoter types even differed in their histone modifications and were more enriched in the classical, let's say, promoter mark HVP for trimethylation, while others were more enriched in the HVP for monomethylation. And some of you might now already think, you know, whether this is cool or not and how the cell makes use of it. And it is actually very interesting, right? So, of course, one thing that is more trivial is that the cell or the fly or nature in general might exploit these compatibilities by just regulating different genes differently, right? Where, for example, a P300 program might regulate this gene, but not that. And well, this gene is regulated by a MOF-centric program and not this. So this is one way, and we also saw that some of these programs, for example, P300, is employed at highly regulated, highly cell-type specific genes, while programs around MOF are more employed. unregulated adiabatic motor paths. Here we look at wobble. This is a famous cohesin release factor. And we see that it has two different promoters that rise at two different transcript but also protein isoforms. So a longer protein on the top and a short protein on the bottom. And you see that the promoter that you try to the longer isoform is not compatible with P300 type programs but with a MOF type program, while this shorter isoform can be specifically activated only by P300 type programs and not MOF type program. Meaning the cell has now the ability to specifically regulate either the long or the short or both isoforms essentially independently. And we think this is very interesting when, for example, proteins like WOPL need to be both present in all cells, but also potentially very highly expressed in the nerve cells that feed the egg and the coming embryo to provide it with high levels of certain proteins for the beginning of embryogenesis. So we think this is very cool, and just to quickly see where this is going, so Leo in the lab has been employing mass spectrometry to ask whether these different motor types that differ in sequence and in activity recruit different types of proteins, and we indeed see this. And Oliver has been following up on the different promoter types and found that the different promoters are also dependent on different types of chromatin remodelers. You might also have been wondering, you know, why did they not look at whether certain enhancers need certain cofactors, right? And this is what Christoph and Vanya have been doing. So they have essentially done the opposite. Rather than asking which promoter can be activated by a certain cofactor, they have asked which promoter, which enhancer depends on or relies on a certain cofactor. And this argument is actually much more, you know, recent argument. So we have the results, and for those of you who can make it to the lights of tomorrow, this is what I talk about tomorrow. But for today, I want to wrap up. I told you, that we are super excited about these gene regulatory elements in cancers and how we look both at the encoding of transcriptional patterns but also at the decoding through the cellular machinery. And that, you know, we and many colleagues in the group of course work towards this vision of understanding and development and cell types through our genome, through the four-letter alphabet. And with this, I want to thank the people who did the work and the funders, our collaborators and funding. I mentioned the names of the key players already throughout the talk. And also thank you very much.
A lot of people have tried to look for homologous enhancers across species, and even between mosquitoes and flies, which are relatively closely related, people have not managed to find homologous enhancers. We've been trying, I mentioned this briefly in my talk, to try and identify enhancers in some conserved genes. I've had numerous grant proposals rejected for attempting to find homologous enhancers because it can't be done. But the motifs are conserved, the cofactors are conserved, the cellular machinery is conserved. Why are the enhancers so unconserved, and why is it so difficult to trace them across evolution?
So I think you can trace them across evolution if you look at very close distances. For example, we published in 2014 a study where we looked at enhancers across six Drosophila species where the genomes align fairly well. And there we see that we can find then by the conservation of function, because we have a functional assay to basically find them through their function. But their sequence is indeed often very diverged, and which makes it very difficult to see them by sequence comparisons. And I think one of the problems of why we cannot find them with the tools that we like to use, like BLAST and so forth, or regular sequence, genome sequence alignments, is that we don't understand the nature of the code. So even when we align protein coding sequence, right, we see that the third codon is often diverged. Right? Meaning if you didn't know that, and if you didn't use tricks like T plus X or so, then you might also there not see a conservation, right? Because you would not find the protein coding sequence perfectly conserved. You would always have this third codon mismatch. And interesting if you take approaches that are more informed by how enhancers work. Right? For example, I mean, we have not done this, but people like UC Tampa, they had a paper on this.
We're collaborating with Mark Alphon. Buffalo is also doing similar things, with very limited success.
Yes, that's unfortunate, because if you looked at the presence of motifs and allow them to be shuffled around, then you might be more successful. But of course, once the divergence is too strong, they might not work. We actually did a fun experiment, unsuccessfully, where we cloned, I think it was 10 enhancers from the human, from a tissue or cell type, neurons and muscle that we thought also based on Eric's work, for example, should be highly conserved, right? And even regulated by the same types of transcription factor, you know, the MEF2, heart muscle, cough muscle. And they also didn't work in fly. So at least between human and fly, we also couldn't find any out of 10. I think within insects, it should be possible.
We're actually trying that approach as well, trying to take putative enhancers from our species and put them into Drosophila. So that's work in progress. We'll see if that works.
Yeah, so this should be more successful. So basically the decoding of enhancers by different species that has worked even across very long distances. I remember when there was a zebrafish to mouse conservation, for example.
Also.
Or even, yeah, exactly.
I was wondering if you're going to, as well as adopting an essentially descriptive approach to try to work out what's going on in the natural fly, whether or not a synthetic approach where you try to build a completely artificial enhancer or set of enhancers that will drive in a way that you might feel you are able to predict. I mean, are you close to that point, or are you still finding facts that will allow you to do that?
We have not done this in the fly embryo, but we have in the cell line where we have sufficiently many enhancers to train these deep learning networks. We have trained a deep learning network based on the existing naturally occurring enhancers, and have then used the rules that we learned to create synthetic enhancers, so purely synthetic enhancers. And this worked beautifully well. It's in this bioarchive paper, where we can even design enhancers with specific activity levels. So we can design a weak enhancer, a medium enhancer, a strong enhancer, build it completely from scratch with no reuse of endogenous sequence, and it works. So this is now in a single cell type where we can only look at strength or levels of activity. But one goal that we now have, and Stan Ars, for example, is also very close to this, I think, is now to also use these rules that we can learn to build enhancers that would then work in a particular pattern in the flying field.
I just ask one other thing. Just it's related to the question about it, rapid evolution. This has been seen in mammalian systems also. And I just wonder if you can envisage ways in which an enhancer driven by certain combinations of transcription factors can turn into an enhancer that does more or less the same thing driven by different transcription factors, if that's what's happening. If you look within Drosophila melanogaster at different lines, can you see differences? Because I believe in mice they were able to see the beginnings of instability even within the single species. I just wonder if you
something
like that.
So we have not looked at whether or not entirely distinct transcription vectors can drive the same enhancers in different species. But what we have done, it's also in this 2014 paper, is to repeat a classic experiment from Martin Friedman, where we basically tested hybrid enhancers, right? Where the idea was if the motifs are conserved, for example, at the 5 gram end of the enhancer or the middle of the 3 gram end, then a hybrid enhancer that contains, for example, half the melanogaster sequence and the other half the scleroscopora sequence should also work. And there we confirmed this classic experiment from Friedman lab that these hybrid enhancers don't work as intended, meaning that there is a lot of moving around of motifs in the enhancers.
Alex, it's still unclear to me how you recruit polymerase in the system, and the question is, do you have some promoter subtype or classes where you already have polymerase sitting on this opposing polymerase? Polymerase will come with some of these cofactors, for example, with P300. So if you recruit with a cofactor which is not P300, how do you get rid of P300 which is on the polymerase?
Yeah, so we are doing currently, this is what Leo is doing with this mass spec experiment. It's very interesting because there we ask exactly what are the promoters already sufficient to recruit by themselves. And the paper has now huge problems because I think we're going a little bit against dogma. So what is very interesting is that most, if not all, of the biochemistry and the structural biology that we know of promoters is always done with Tanabox promoters. Very few exceptions. And Tanabox promoters can, in vitro, if you just take naked Tanabox promoter DNA, and they can in vitro assemble the peak and partly even the polymerase. But some of these other promoter types cannot. So they rely on the polymerase to brought in by the cofactors. And we have seen that some of these cofactors, for example, a cofactor that we didn't talk about today, PUTSIG, but also a TREF and Promator and GFCF, which I did show, they can hook onto the peak through TIF2A directly and basically bring in the POL2 machinery through TIF2A. And these are also exactly the types of promoters that have this so-called dispersed transcriptional initiation patterns, where you don't have a single dominant transcription starting site, but you have, you know, 5 or 6 or 10 transcription starting sites. So we see this very interesting correlation, where some promoters, like the Tanabox, can recruit basically the peak itself, and others cannot.
You think this system, this system of multiple type of promoters, has evolved in genomes where genes are packed, in fact, and where you somehow need some kind of discrimination not to activate an evolved gene and so on? Does it exist in vertebrates?
Yeah, so this is not clear. But now, we haven't done this so far, and there are now 3 or 4 papers out of preprints that are controversial, let's say. So some find it and others don't. We have now one project where we go after factors that are specifically only able to activate CDGR promoters and not Tanabox promoters, and we have some of them. So there might be something in mammals, but it has been difficult to find it. So. Yes.
Alex, fascinating. About the promoters with the K3, K4 monomethylation and trimethylation. So what your thought about this? Some of them like function as enhancers of other promoter, like it's a promoter enhancer with some evidence in human or in mammalian for that. What the difference between the decoration?
So also there we haven't looked at mammals, but in the fly, what is very interesting is that these HVK for monomethyl promoters are again the developmental type promoters, and we think that they have the enhancers very close to the promoter. Right? But it's not that the enhancer has K4 mono and the promoter still has K4 tri. It's that the proximity of the enhancer to this promoter basically makes the entire region K4 mono heavy. I can actually show you this here. So this is actually you see that, you know, this promoter here is of this housekeeping type, and it has this very clear addition of K4 trimethyl. This promoter here, even though there's also this K4 tri, it has a much more dominant K4 mono signature. We don't exactly know where this is coming from, but it correlates also very strongly with these two classes.
Can I just ask a more, especially sort of zoom out on some aspect of Denise's question also? In mammalian cases, when you're basically looking at these very large genomic regions, if you're trying to find enhancers that map to promoters, obviously people are using ataxic peaks as a search method. And I think it's many people's experience that deleting promoters that are identified
yes, I do. I think the difference between the numbers, right, is indeed just the very short sizes of the genome that makes everything very compact. I mean, we have a median gene-to-gene distance of only 500 base pairs, right, which of course crams all the enhancers very closely together. But also in the fly, we see that a taxi or DHS that we use is not a very good predictor of enhancer activities, because of course other elements are also accessible and are not enhancers. For example, when we didn't do this with the embryo data, but when we looked at another assay that can essentially find enhancers across the genome, we saw that the taxi peaks that were not enhancers were, for example, insulated binding sites or promoters and so forth. So there are DHS peaks that are not enhancers. So that's for one. But the other thing is that we're also asking different questions. So there are even elements in the genome that can function as enhancers, but that doesn't mean, as is the case, for example, for the sonic hedgehog gene, that if you delete that, the gene expression goes away. Because very often you have two or three enhancers that act as backups for it.
Or 20. I mean, 20 is common.
Or more, exactly. Yeah. So this enhanced redundancy, that you observe potentially more often in the mammalian case, but we also see that in the fly case. Right? So the fact that an enhancer can be sufficient to drive the panel does not always mean that it's also necessary for to drive the panel, because other enhancers can basically back up.
So Alex, I'm looking at this cartoon and also examples of basic developmental enhancers where there are multiple transcription factors binding both proteins. What do you think are their differential contributions? The different factors recruit different cofactors, and so I'm trying to somehow connect your approach to the classical endo-16 studies where you would say that different pieces different levels of transcription activity. So how do you think of this multiple transcription factors and multiple cofactors? How can this be?
So I think the approach that I showed today is probably most similar to Mark Bertaschner's activator bypass type experiment, right? So we're basically bypassing the level of the transcription factors and directly recruit cofactors.
Then I understood that in reality you have multiple transcription factors and
But how different transcription factors function together and what each of the different transcription factors contributes, I think that is still unclear. So there is one school of thought is that they collaborate at the level of binding, right? So they compete out the nucleosome. Many modelers that approach this through thermodynamic models computationally, they just assign little activators or repressive activities. We had one study.
But those models typically do not have cofactors.
Exactly, they have not cofactors. We had one study where we basically asked whether, if we break an enhancer, because the problem is, these are highly combinatorial systems, right? They have tens of motifs. And the interesting thing is now, if you mutate motifs, you don't see, a 10% decrease or so, right? So you often have a crash of activity if you just mutate one or two. Meaning we have a highly synergistic system where many motifs are required, but none of these motifs are sufficient. I use the car analogy, right, where you can easily break a car by removing the engine, but it doesn't mean that the engine makes a car. And that made it very difficult for us to study. But what we have done a few years ago is we have basically broken enhancers by mutating motif, right, the enhancer is dead. And then we have used this Gal4 trick to bring in different transcription factors and ask which of the transcription factors can rescue. There we found that there are different types of transcription factors that can or cannot rescue. And so we haven't been able to follow up on this, whether they, for example, just combinatorially make up binding sites for the same set of cofactors, or whether they each recruit different cofactors and the cofactors somehow synergize. This we don't understand mechanistically. And I think that's kind of, at least from this mechanistic biochemical side of understanding enhanced function, that's for me kind of the next frontier that we should, as a field, try to understand.
Can you relate between a chronic enhancer and a certain
in terms of the positions of the enhancers, we have not seen any correlation with the types of cofactors. Only in the sense that what I call host housing enhancers today, that I am working through morph and promoter, they are typically very close to the promoter itself. So I think many of us call them the promoter because they are within the 500 to 2 kb upstream region. The only correlation, but it was not very strong, that we found between neutronic enhancers was a slight CDK7 dependence or a higher dependence on CDK7. So this is in this other work that I will show tomorrow on the right side. But this is a very weak effect, so I don't exactly understand what this is doing. Otherwise, neutronic enhancers seem to work just fine, and you can also use the RAD placed upstream, they work just fine. Which is interesting, right? It also gives us some indications of the mechanistics of enhancers. If polymerase can happily run through the enhancer without disrupting its activity, that means something about the dynamics of binding. So it's not a rigid complex of cofactors and transcriptors, but it's more maybe an enrichment of these proteins surrounding the enhancers in a very flexible and dynamic way.
Thank you very much.
Process. But I want to start out by thanking Ute for kindly inviting me and also for challenging me with the task to talk to an interdisciplinary and interfaculty audience, and I hope that I do strike the balance right between biology or say general introduction to the topic and what we actually do. When most people think about genomes and DNA, they might associate that with the famous double-digit structure that explains beautifully so much of the DNA-associated functions. But what I would like you to think about today for the purpose of this talk is of the human genome as a very long string of four letters, namely the famous A's and C's and G's and T's. And when I mean very long, I really mean very long. So T.A. Brown in this book, the Genomes, estimates that if you printed it out in regular font size, it would stretch over 5,000 kilometers from London to Montreal, for example. And you needed 3,000 books to print the human genome. In today's world of cell phones and so forth, I have to, however, also tell you that because it's only a four-letter alphabet, the human genome is actually less than a gigabyte of data in total. And yet, this simple four-letter alphabet, less than a gigabyte of it, can somehow encode the development of an entire organism that is as complex as our bodies. It contains information to make about 20,000 different proteins, and it also contains the information about when and where these different proteins are to be activated, that is, expressed, such that the different cell types and organs in our bodies all adopt different morphologies and fulfill different functions. So only certain protein, like for example the hemoglobin precursors, are expressed in the blood cells, while certain neurotransmitter responsive channels are specifically activated and expressed only in neurons. And to come to the topic of this workshop, I think the fact that this information is essentially digital, right, in a four-letter digital alphabet, it can immediately suggest how you can have continuity and how this same digital information can be decoded independently into identical forms, as we see, for example, in identical twins. But it also suggests immediately how differences, mutations in this alphabet or in these letters can lead to changes, as we, for example, observe, of course, throughout evolution, where over the course of these 5 to 7 million years that separate us from our closest relative, the chimp, have these about 4% sequence differences in the genome that leads to these differences in morphologies. And because the genome instructs development, many people use the analogy of a construction plan or a blueprint, but because it's the gene expression regulation of when and where the different genes are to be activated is the most important thing. Eric Davidson introduced this gene regulatory network concept, where it is specifically the connection between the genes and how they regulate and co-regulate each other that is the key feature of cell type differentiation and development. And you see already this circuit board structure, these regulatory connections, and they impinge on regulatory elements that listen to many different signals from other genes that are expressed in a particular cell type or external signals, and then integrate all these cues to essentially start regulating transcription and thus expression. And these elements are what fascinate me and the group and what we are trying to figure out how they work. And I'll show you just with one example how such elements that I call here enhancers for the reasons I will mention in a second are important, that is necessary for transcription. So in this case, when you delete the enhancer that is responsible for the transcription of the sonic hedgehog gene in developing the buds, here, you lose the gene expression. And you also lose the structures that are defined through this signaling molecule. So you essentially develop mice that lack limb structures altogether. But what is really cool about these elements, and this is where a lot of our work and our essays are based on, is that they're also sufficient to drive certain gene expression patterns. So you can essentially copy these DNA sequences out of their endogenous genomic context and bring them together with a heterologous promoter and a reporter gene, the expression of which you can visualize, like GFP or like Z in this example, and the sequence will faithfully drive transcription again in the correct cell types or body parts. And you see here again the expression of now this reporter gene in the thin buds. Meaning the element is sufficient to drive transcription and it is containing the information that is required to drive gene transcription specifically in these structures. And this is not an isolated example. When our colleagues in Berkeley from the Pinacchio and Pisa labs cloned exactly these sequences, exactly as I printed here on this slide, they give faithfully and reproducibly rise to these expression patterns. Where this sequence drives gene expression in the forebrain, this one in the neural tube, stomites, and the lips. And I want to stress how cool that is, because what it means is that these very sequences, with their simple alphabet, somehow encode the information of when the gene is to be expressed that is turned on, but also implicitly where it is not expressed, i.e. turned off, and how by just a change of sequence, you can encode an entirely different pattern where now gene expression is not on anymore in the forebrain, but in the little structures as I showed you before. And these DNA elements that encode this gene activating function have been termed enhancers in the early 80s by another scientific hero of mine, Walter Schaffner, here in about 2015 or so with his team. And these will be also the focus of today's talk. More specifically, I want to first, in a hopefully accessible way, discuss all the work that we did to start understanding exactly the sequence encoding of gene regulatory information. So what in these sequences is required or encodes the information. And then I want to look a little bit at the cellular machinery that the cells use to actually read and utilize these sequences. But first things first. So it has been a long standing dream of mine to understand how nature found a way to use essentially a digital encoding in a four-letter alphabet of gene expression patterns. So how and which elements in this overall sequence are required to drive specific gene expression patterns. And we took a very simple approach to that intellectually by essentially thinking that if you simply had sufficiently many DNA sequences and their corresponding gene expression patterns, like this for example, assume that potentially these shared functionalities or these shared activities somehow are reflected in shared sequence element, that these similarities could allow you to recompute how exactly the information is encoded or what some people might call a regulatory code. This strategy would definitely work for the genetic code by which the genome encodes proteins. And we were wondering if it also, to a certain extent at least, would work to understand gene regulation and the gene regulatory code. But in order to do this, we couldn't really afford mouse as a model system. So we switched 14 years ago when I moved to Vienna with the help of Barry Dixon at the time to the Drosophila embryo. This is this rice corn like and size and shape structures in the life cycle of the fruit fly to understand this relationship between DNA sequence and expression patterns. And more specifically, we characterized about 8,000 overlapping 2-kb long sequences with a reporter assay similar to the one that I introduced you before, and determined whether they were driving a transcription of reporter genes, and if yes, in which patterns. So here, for example, you see a Drosophila embryo with a gene that is expressed in the central nervous systems of the brain and the ventral nerve cord, or whether the sequence is not active in terms of gene regulation. And if you need one, our first PhDs in the lab, together with other colleagues, was able to successfully stay with an in situ hybridization that essentially visualizes the transcript presence, more than 7,700 enhanced candidates, of which, and this was very surprising to us at the time, of which almost half are active at some stage in embryogenesis and in some pattern. And some of these you see here in the background of these slides really span from very simple stride-like patterns in the early embryo when segmentation occurs, we heard about this yesterday, to patterns that already highlight the specific and individual organ structures, like again here the central nervous system and the embryos. And what is very cool is that we find repeatedly throughout the genome entirely different sequences that wouldn't be similar by eye, giving rise to very similar or even identical gene expression patterns, showing that there is a strong flexibility in how nature can actually encode these gene expression patterns. And when we look at a single gene locus, for example, the transcriptional gene of TSP, here where the thick lines in black are the exons and the thin lines are the regions of the gene, which is transcribed here from right to left. We can look at how and where the fly genome encodes these gene expression patterns. So if you look here at the left of this black line, you see where the gene is expressed. These are data from Paolo Tomanczak's in situ hybridization database that visualizes endogenous native gene expression. So at these early embryonic stages, correspondence is expressed only in the simple posterior domain. And then to the right of this line, you see the different tiles, blue, the active ones, with their particular activity pattern. And you see that these early embryonic stages, it's this intronic tile, the single intronic enhancer that explains the expression of the transcriptional gene. But if you now move forward to later stages of embryonic development, you see that gene expression diversifies. It gains expression in the head and then also at this muscle attachment site, so around the body wall. And it is now different enhancers in this gene locus that essentially additively give rise to this gene expression pattern. Well, this enhancer still contributes this pattern at this site. This one, the expression in the head region, and then these enhancers, the expression of the transcriptional gene around the body wall. And if you go yet one embryonic stage later, this is one of my favorite examples, I like to show it. It is that this enhancer these enhancer activities and gene expressions are in development, so going basically vertically top to bottom, but also how additively different enhancers contribute different gene expression patterns that now horizontally add up to the overall gene expression pattern. And this modularity is very interesting also from an evolutionary perspective, because you could imagine that genes might just evolve yet an additional enhancer, you know, say this one, and thereby gain expression in the particular cell type or tissue. And vice versa, if that enhancer, say, gets deleted or inactivated, you wouldn't lose the overall expression pattern throughout the entire body, but you would, again, specifically and exclusively only lose gene expression pattern in a particular structure or particular cell type, which in fact helped Drosophila geneticists to identify some of the genes and the associated knockout phenotypes. And I want to just here, in this example, all the gene regulatory elements were essentially within the boundaries of the genes and within the gene's intron. But this is not the rule. So there are other genes in the fly embryo, like, for example, SOX-N, that is a very short and intron-less gene where all the regulatory elements are now around in this about 60 kb long gene desert. And you again see how the overall gene expression pattern that I now placed in the middle of this slide is again explained additively by all the different enhancers, of which I counted 28 to give rise to this gene expression pattern. I found this is really very beautiful. And you of course also see this similar ways throughout animals. But let's come back to the original question. Can we use this mapping of sequence to function to identify rules about how nature actually encodes these patterns? I want to remind you that every one of these embryos reflects a single 2kb DNA sequence and the activity of that DNA sequence if coupled to a reporter gene. And we can now go through and collect different sequences that give rise to similar or identical patterns, like here again, the central nervous system. And hence, we can ask, and at the time, about 6 to 8 years ago by now, we did this by simply asking whether sequences that were active in the central nervous system, for example, or in other tissues, shared particular short DNA words, right, or that we like to call motifs, that occur substantially more frequently in the active sequences than in the inactive sequences, or in sequences that are active but in different patterns. And Omar could, just by counting these motifs, so looking at motif presence essentially, train a support vector machine. This is basically a simple, relatively simple artificial intelligence approach to discriminate unseen sequences into whether they were active or inactive with almost 80% accuracy. Meaning that the motif content of these sequences already explained a lot about whether or not the sequences were active and in which tissues they were active. But of course, because we wanted to understand the encoding, we also wanted to know which motifs or which patterns were actually used by the computer to make these predictions. And for example, for this CNS enhancer, it was motifs like this, GAGA or GAGA, which is the transcription factor binding motif recognized by the tartoric-like transcription factor.
Alexander, this was stage-specific or across all structures?
So this was for a stage 11, 12 CNS, but it is for many of the CNS enhancers that we do this. If we now zoom out and look at all the different enhancer activity patterns here on the left versus different known Drosophila transcription factor motifs, right, we see already this checkerboard pattern that I now use blue for enrichment, that different enhanced types with different activity patterns. genetics, as was, for example, the enrichment of the MAF2 transcription factor motif for this mesodermal somatic muscle cancer type, or the Timon and Panier, we heard this yesterday also from Aline, motifs in cancer related to the dorsal vessel, which is the Drosophila heart.
Can you explain, please, what are the columns and the rows?
So basically, the rows here are different activity patterns that we label by tissue type. So the example here are broad CNS patterns, ubiquitously active promoters, guts, gene derivatives, and then the individual columns are so tiny that you can see them, are basically the motifs. Right? So that's why I, for example, here I zoomed in, and you see that, for example, the dorsal vessel structures are enriched in this team and the type of tissue.
So how many of these motifs can be assigned to the normal transcription factors? Well, do you have some more?
So for this, we used only the known and independently conditionally predicted ones. So for example, this one was an independently predicted motif that we, however, think might also be binding to that. So here we did not do what people call the de novo discovery. We find a tile in the patterns for which no transcription factor is known. And of course, we were interested in whether these motifs now are indeed required and important for enhanced activities. And that's why Evgeny, for this type of enhancer, so the central nervous system enhancer, mutated the motifs that the computer predicted to be important. So in this case, the Geiger motif, and indeed, if we mutate the Geiger motif, this enhancer is inactive. So even though we specifically mutated only a very short stretch within the longer enhancer. And I had actually hidden the slide, but enough to just show you that this is also true for different types of patterns, and in each case he mutated not only one enhancer, but in this case three, of which three show the dependency. Here we're talking about mid-gut on the GABA motif, for example. We mutated the GABA motif in 4 out of 4 CNS enhancers and so forth. So this very nicely illustrates that A, and this is a first take-home message, that it is the DNA sequences that in a essentially binary or digital form encode these gene expression patterns, and that complex gene expression patterns are typically regulated by multiple enhancers that act additively, and that within the sequences it is the motifs, such short words, that are essentially the key units of both encoding and decoding, because they are recognized by cellular proteins. I mentioned some of them already that we call transcription factors. And as an outlook where we are going, right, I told you that this 2014 work from the PhD student Omar was essentially only based on counting the presence of motifs. While we now, and this is work from Bernardo, that is available in our archive, uses these convolutional neural networks that people also call deep learning approaches to predict now enhanced activities quantitatively and can go much beyond the presence of motifs and also look at the arrangements, the distances and so forth that are. But for the second and shorter part of the talk, I want to now switch away from how DNA sequences encode this gene regulatory information to, you know, what I here kind of depicted as the hardware of the switch, namely to how the cellular machineries decode this information. Meaning, while we so far have really only looked at the naked DNA sequence and how that relates to gene expression activity, we now want to bring the cellular proteins that decode this information into the picture. I already mentioned transcription factors that bind in a sequence-specific way to these motifs and thereby essentially read or decode the enhanced sequence directly at the DNA level. But I want to talk about these cofactor proteins that is a layer, if you wish, of non-DNA binding proteins recruited by these transcription factors histone methyl transferases, for example, from the MLR families, histone acetyl transferases, XVP300, the histone acetyl binders, the VRD family, or different kinases, but also the very large mediator complex. And one question that we were wondering about is whether all these different proteins that were implicated in the activation of transcription, whether they could all activate just any promoter, or whether they had some specific or inherent compatibility with some promoters and not others. And we were wondering, you know, whether a cool approach would be to answer this question systematically. And we felt that the ideal experiment that one would want to do is to take a very large number of promoters, shown here as these little boxes, and then bring a selected cofactor to these promoters and ask whether the cofactor could activate the promoters, shown here in red, or not, shown here in white. And then essentially repeat that experiment for different types of cofactors, such that one might find certain cofactors activating one set of promoters that is then not activated by other types of cofactors, while other types of cofactors will activate other different sets of promoters. So we thought this would be a really systematic way of understanding if there is any specificity or compatibility between the cellular machineries, the cofactors, and the different promoter types that, you know, we have in our genomes and the fly has too. And Vanya Cosmos and Nikki in the lab set out to do exactly that. Now, in one particular Drosophila cell type or cell line that we can easily manipulate and use in the lab. And they realized this by cloning a very large collection of about 70,000 promoter candidates. So these are, of course, many more sequences than the Drosophila has promoters, but we put essentially anything that has ever been observed to initiate transcription plus many negative controls to make the data interpretable. And they placed this library in front of four UAS sites, which are sequences that can very specifically recruit a yeast transcription vector DAL4 that does not have any regulatory capacities in fly cells that can be used as a tether to bring now specific cofactors to this site. And we reasoned that if a certain cofactor can activate transcription from a certain promoter, then we would obtain arrays that started and with a specific 5' sequence or sequence tag derived from the core promoter that was activated. Such that, for example, activation of the yellow promoter would lead to recall transcripts that start with the end of the yellow promoter sequence, and activation of the blue promoter would give rise to promoter RNAs that would start with parts of the blue promoter. Such that in a single experiment, without testing every promoter one by one, we could identify and quantify the activation of the different promoter types by next generation sequencing, and essentially map back these reporter abundances to the respective promoter type. And let me show you with a simple example how the data look like, because I think they're really cool. So if Vanya and Cosmas recruit GFP as a negative control, GFP shouldn't be able to activate any transcription, then you indeed don't see any transcription in this gene locus. However, if they recruit either P300 or MOF, which are two different acetyl transferases, so they have the same type of enzymatic function but are specific to different types of histone tails, then you see that P300 specifically activates this promoter here to transcribe to the right, and this promoter here to transcribe to the left, which is indicated by this tick going down. While MOF, despite its identical enzymatic function, does not activate any of these promoters, but instead activates this promoter here and this promoter here. So we have already, by looking at only two someone protein gene promoter cannot be activated by B400 norm off, but specifically by a promoter.
And this is even though we, through this GAL4 tethering trick, bring every cofactor to every promoter. Suggesting that we are here looking at true compatibilities, where a cellular machinery can or cannot talk to or activate different types of promoters. And we, when we look now at the entire data set and use a coloring scheme similar to what Alan used before, where red is activation or high expression and blue is lower expression, and you see that about 70,000 proteins or promoters or so were now off the negative ones that cannot be activated at all. They fall into five distinct groups where group one is predominantly activated by P65, P300 on the P25, group two the most strongly by the P25, group three by MOF that I mentioned before, group four by Chromator, and group four by GSF. So we have, in an identical experiment, covered five distinct compatibilities where promoters, by means of having different sequences, respond very differently to these activators. And we were, of course, wondering now what again in these promoter sequences determine whether they are, for example, of type 1 and respond particularly strongly to P65, or of type 4 and respond particularly strongly to the promoter. And for this, Vanya turned to a representation of whether or not the different promoter sequences contain certain motifs and where by this blue and white type map, where if you look, for example, here at the tether box, blue demarcates the position of tether boxes along the different promoters that are now stacked on top of each other. And you see that group one promoters and slightly also group two promoters, but not the five promoters have tether boxes. Another, and they sit, if you look closely, so here is the TSS in the middle of the box, they sit, as is well known for tether boxes, about 30 base pair upstream of the TSS. While group one and two promoters contain initiator motifs at the TSS directly to similar amounts. But when we now look at these completely differently behaving promoters of type 3 and 4, they contain, for example, this polar 1 or 6 motifs or other types of motifs, but not these types of motifs here on the map. And I think this mutual presence or absence is much more easily seen if we display that in terms of enrichment across the entire cancer group. We now see, again in red, that the tala box is most strongly enriched in cluster 1, and in fact actually being depleted in clusters 3 to 5, while initiator is enriched similarly to cluster 1 and 2 promoters. And again, our cluster 3 promoters are enriched in this OLA 1, 6, DRE and OLA 7 motifs, and the strongest enrichment that we see for cluster 4 is actually the TCT motif, which is a motif identified by Chimpanaga that occurs specifically at the ribosomal protein gene promoters. And you might remember that we had a ribosomal protein gene promoter of the ribosomal protein gene 19S that actually does form cluster 4 and is specifically, as you remember, activated by promoter. So we have now a really cool model where the presence of these motifs dictate the binding of general transcription factors and other factors. And we could actually test this by published CHIP-seq and CHIP-nexus data from the cyclings lab, where again, TDP is most strongly bound in cluster 1, which fits exactly to the enrichment of the tether box in cluster 1. And you see this also quantified here, with the tether box being most strongly bound by cluster 1. While, for example, TRF2 paralog is more strongly bound by classes 3 to 5 promoters. And again, in agreement with the prediction by the motif enrichment, the TAF1, which binds to the initial motif, is bound to groups 1 and 2 predominantly, as it is here quantified.
while the motif 1 binding protein binds predominantly to cluster 3, again as indicated by the strong enrichment of the only one motif, that is the binding motif in promoters of cluster 3, and ref in clusters 3, but also somewhat in clusters 4, for example. Again, coinciding with the enrichment of the DRE motif in clusters 3 and 4. So, in sum, we have looked at how cellular proteins that communicate between the enhancers and the promoters and have the ability to activate transcription show distinct compatibilities, highlighting that distinct promoters exist and that it is the sequences again of these promoters with the presence of short motifs that dictate both general transcription factor binding and then also the responsiveness to the different cofactors. And one other more unexpected observation that we made was that some of the promoter types even differed in their histone modifications and were more enriched in the classical, let's say, promoter mark HVP for trimethylation, while others were more enriched in the HVP for monomethylation. And some of you might now already think, you know, whether this is cool or not and how the cell makes use of it. And it is actually very interesting, right? So, of course, one thing that is more trivial is that the cell or the fly or the nature in general might exploit these compatibilities by just regulating different genes differently. Right? Where, for example, a P300 program might regulate this gene, but not that, and well, this gene is regulated by a MOF-centric program and not this. So this is one way, and we also saw that some of these programs, for example, P300, is employed at highly regulated, highly cell-specific genes, while programs around MOF are more employed at housekeeping type genes that are expressed in many different cells. But we found even more interesting patterns where, for example, different isoforms of the same gene are regulated by distinct promoter types. Here we look at WOPL. This is a famous cohesin release factor. And you see that it has two different promoters that derive two different transcript but also protein isoforms. So a longer protein on the top and a short protein on the bottom. And you see that the promoter that derives the longer isoform is not compatible with P300 type programs but with a MOF type program, while this shorter isoform can be specifically activated only by P300 type programs and not MOF type programs. Meaning the cell has now the ability to specifically regulate either the long or the short or both isoforms essentially independently. And we think this is very interesting when, for example, proteins like WOPL need to be both present in all cells, but also potentially very highly expressed in the nerve cells that feed the egg and the coming embryo to provide it with high levels of certain proteins for the beginning of embryogenesis. So we think this is very cool, and just to quickly see where this is going, so Leo in the lab has been employing mass spectrometry to ask whether these different promoter types that differ in sequence and in activity recruit different types of proteins, and we indeed see this. And Oliver has been following up on the different promoter types and found that the different promoters are also dependent on different types of chromatin remodeling. You might also have been wondering, you know, why did they not look at whether certain enhancers need certain cofactors, right? And this is what Christoph and I have been doing. So they have essentially done the opposite. Rather than asking which promoter can be activated by a certain cofactor, they have asked which promoter, which enhancer depends on or relies on a certain cofactor. And this argument is actually much more, you know, recent outlook, so we have the results, and for those of you who can make it to the lights for tomorrow, this is what I talk about tomorrow. But for today, I want to wrap up. I told you, you know, that we are super excited about these gene regulatory elements and enhancers, and how we look both at the encoding of transcriptional patterns, but also at the decoding through the cellular machinery, and that, you know, we and question of understanding development and cell types through our genome, through the fallen alphabet. And with this, I'm going to thank the people who did the work and the funders, our funders and funding. I mentioned the names of the key players already throughout the talk. And also thank you. So this should be more successful. So basically the decoding of enhancers by different species that has worked even across very long distances. I remember there was a zebrafish to mouse conservation, for example.
Also.
Or even, yeah, exactly.
Thanks.
I was wondering if you're going to, as well as adopting an essentially descriptive approach to try to work out what's going on in the natural fly, whether or not a synthetic approach where you try to build a completely artificial enhancer or set of enhancers that will drive in a way that you might feel you're able to predict. I mean, are you close to that point, or are you still finding facts that will allow you to do that?
We have not done this in the fly embryo, but we have in the model cell line where we have sufficiently many enhancers to train this learning networks. We have trained a deep learning network based on the existing naturally occurring enhancers and have then used the rules that we learned to create synthetic enhancers, purely synthetic enhancers. And this worked beautifully well. It's in this bioarchive paper where we can even design enhancers with specific activity.
inside a weak enhancer, a medium enhancer, a strong enhancer, build it, you know, completely from scratch with no reuse of endogenous sequence, and it works. So this is now in a single cell type where we can only look at strength or levels of activity. But one goal that we now have, and Stan Ars, for example, is also very close to this, I think, is now to also use these rules that we can learn to build enhancers that would then work in a particular pattern in the flying field.
I guess that's one of the things, you know, just it's related to the question about it, rapid evolution. You know, this has been seen in the mammalian systems also. And I just wonder if you can envisage ways in which an enhancer driven by certain combinations of transcription factors can turn into an enhancer that does more or less the same thing driven by different transcription factors, if that's what's happening. If you look within Drosophila melanogaster at different lines, can you see differences? Because I believe in mice they were able to see the beginnings of instability even within the single species. I just wonder if you try something like that.
So we have not looked at whether or not entirely distinct transcription vectors can drive the same enhancers in different species. But what we have done, it's also in this 2014 paper, is to repeat a classic experiment from Martin Friedman, where we basically tested hybrid enhancers, right, where the idea was if the motifs are conserved, for example, at the 5' end of the enhancer or the middle of the 3' end, then a hybrid enhancer that contains, for example, half of the melanogaster sequence and the other half of the pseudoscura sequence should also work. And there we confirmed this classic experiment from Friedman lab that these hybrid enhancers don't work as intended, meaning that there is a lot of moving around of motifs in the enhancer sequence.
Alex, it's still unclear to me how you recruit polymerase in the system. And the question is, do you have some promoter subtype or classes where you already have polymerase sitting on this opposing polymerase? Polymerase will come with some of these cofactors, for example, with P300. So if you recruit with a cofactor which is not P300, how do you get rid of P300 which is on the polymerase?
Yeah, so we are doing currently, this is what Leo is doing with this mass spec experiment. It's very interesting because there we ask exactly what are the promoters already sufficient to recruit by themselves. And the paper has now a huge problem because I think we're going a little bit against dogma. So what is very interesting is that most, if not all, of the biochemistry and the structural biology that we know of promoters is always done with Tadalox promoters. Very few exceptions. And Tadalox promoters can, in vitro, if you just take naked Tadalox promoter DNA, right, they can in vitro assemble the peak and partly even polymerase. But some of these other promoter types cannot. So they rely on the polymerase being brought in by the cofactors. And we have seen that some of these cofactors, for example, a cofactor that I didn't talk about today, Putzig, but also DREF and Chromator and GFCF, which I did show, they can hook onto the peak through TF2A directly and basically bring in the POL2 machinery through TF2A. And these are also exactly the types of promoters that have the so-called dispersed transcriptional initiation patterns, where you don't have a single dominant transcription starting site, but you have, you know, 5 or 6 or 10 transcription starting sites. So we see this very interesting correlation, where some promoters, like the Tadalox, can recruit basically the peak itself, and others cannot.
You think this system just... the system of multiple type of promoters has evolved in genomes where genes are packed, in fact, and where you somehow need some kind of discrimination not to activate an evolved gene and so on. Does it exist in vertebrates?
Yeah, so this is not clear. Now, we haven't done this so far, and there are now 3 or 4 papers out of preprints that are controversial, let's say. So some find it and others don't. We have now one project where we go after factors that are specifically only able to activate CDGI promoters and not Tadalox promoters. And we have some of them. So there might be something in mammals, but it has been difficult to find it. So.
Alex?
Yes.
fascinating. About the promoters with the K3, K4 monomethylation and trimethylation. So what your thought about these? Some of them like function as enhancers of other promoter, like it's a promoter enhancer with some evidence in human or in mammalian for that. What the difference between the correlation?
So also there we haven't looked at mammals, but in the fly, what is very interesting is that these HUK for monomethyl promoters are again the developmental path promoters. And we think that they have the enhancers very close to the promoter. Right? But it's not that the enhancer has K for mono and the promoter still has K for tri, it's that the proximity of the enhancer to this promoter basically makes the entire HUK for mono heavy. I can actually show you this here. So this is actually you see that, you know, this promoter here is of this housekeeping type, and it has this very clear function for trimethyl. This promoter here, even though there's also this K for tri, it has a much more dominant K for mono signature. We don't exactly know where this is coming from, but it correlates also very strongly with these two classes.
Ask a more, especially sort of zoom out on some aspect of Denise's question also. In the mammalian cases, when you're basically looking at these very large genomic regions, if you're trying to find enhancers that map to promoters, obviously people are using ataxic peaks as a search method. And I think it's many people's experience that deleting promoters that are identified by ataxic features and often gives extremely weak effects on promoters. So as a mammalian person looking at your 50% positive hits, it was incredibly, it was shocking and exciting. So because even the attacking selected peaks tend to be very weak in their effects. So how, when you think about what this observation in the mammalian system, how do you read this? I mean, what do you think is different about the Drosophila system? And what do you think about the evolution of control of developmental patterns? I mean, these are small incremental effects of promoters as opposed to rather large, highly modularized, self-contained effects of enhancers in the Drosophila case. Do you think there's a continuum between these modes of regulation, or what do you think is going on?
Yes, I do. I think the difference between the numbers, right, is indeed just the very short size of the Drosophila gene that makes everything very compact. I mean, we have a median gene-to-gene distance of only 500 base pairs, which of course rams all the enhancers very closely together. But also in the fly, we see that a taxi or DHS that we use is not a very good predictor of enhancer activities, because of course other elements are also accessible and are not enhancers. For example, when we didn't do this with the embryo data, but when we looked at another assay that can essentially find enhancers across the genome, we saw that the taxi peaks that were not enhancers were, for example, insulated binding sites or promoters and so forth. So there are DHS peaks that are not enhancers. So that's for one. But the other thing is that we're also asking different questions. So there are even elements in the human genome that can function as enhancers, but that doesn't mean, as is the case, for example, for the sonic hedgehog gene, that if you delete that, the gene expression goes away, because very often you have two or three enhancers that act as backups for each
other. Or 20. I mean, 20 is common.
Or more, exactly. Yeah. So this enhanced redundancy, that you observe potentially more often in the mammalian case, but we also see that in the flight case. Right? So the fact that an enhancer can be sufficient to drive the pattern does not always mean that it's also necessary for it to drive the pattern, because other enhancers can basically back up.
So Alex, I'm looking at this cartoon and also examples of basic developmental enhancers where there are multiple transcription factors binding both proximities. What do you think are their differential contributions? The different factors record different cofactors and so forth.
approach that I showed today is probably most similar to Mark Natasha's activated bypass type experiment, right? So we're basically bypassing the level of the transcription factors and directly recruit
programs. Then understood that in reality you have multiple transcription factors and, you know,
yes. And but how different transcription factors function together and what each of the different transcription factors contributes, I think that is still unclear. So there's one school of thought is that they collaborate at the level of binding, right? So they compete out the nucleosome. Many modelers that approach this through thermodynamic models computationally, they just assign little activators or repressive activities. We had one study.
But those models typically do not have cofactors.
Exactly, they have not cofactors. We had one study where we basically asked whether, you know, if we break an enhancer. Because the problem is, these are highly combinatorial systems, right? They have tens of motifs. And the interesting thing is now, if you mutate motifs, you don't see, you know, a 10% decrease or so, right? So you often have a crash of activity if you just mutate one or two motifs. Meaning we have a highly synergistic system where many motifs are required, but none of these motifs are sufficient. I use the car analogy, right, where you can easily break a car by removing the engine, but doesn't mean that the engine makes a car. And that made it very difficult for us to study that. What we have done a few years ago is we have basically broken enhancers by mutating motif, right? The enhancer is dead. And then we have used this GAL4 trick to bring in different transcription factors and ask which of the transcription factors can rescue activity. And there we found that there are different types of transcription factors that can or cannot rescue. And so we haven't been able to follow up on this, whether they, for example, just combinatorially make up binding sites for them the same set of cofactors, or whether they each recruit different cofactors and the cofactors somehow synergize. This we don't understand mechanistically. And I think that's kind of, at least from this mechanistic biochemical side of understanding enhanced function, that's for me kind of the next frontier that we should, as a field, try to understand.
Can you relate between
in terms of the positions of the enhancers, we have not seen any, you know, correlation with the types of cofactors. Only in the sense that what I call host-casting enhancers today, that are, you know, working through morph and promoter day, are typically very close to the promoter itself. So I think many of us call them the promoter because they are within the 500 to 2 kb upstream region. The only correlation, but it was not very strong, that we found between neutronic enhancers was a slight CDK7 dependence or a higher dependence on CDK7. So this is in this other work that I will show tomorrow in Weizen. But this is a very weak effect, so I don't exactly understand what this is coming from. Otherwise, neutronic enhancers seem to work just fine, and you can also use the route placed upstream, they work just fine. Which is interesting, right? It also gives us some indications of the mechanistics of enhancers. If polymerase can happily run through the enhancer without disrupting its activity, that means something about the dynamics of binding. So it's not a rigid complex of cofactors and transcription factors, but it's more maybe an enrichment of these proteins